Thank you. Our call to worship this morning is from the Reverend Amanda Poppy, who right now is serving the Unitarian Universalist congregation in Arlington, Virginia. This is the home that love made. It is full of the love that the founders felt when they planned out these walls and raised these beams above us. This is the home that love made. It is full of the love of all who have worshiped here, those who have celebrated and grieved here, the babies dedicated, couples married, and family members mourned here. This is the home that love made. It is full of the love of our children as they laugh and learn together, and our youth as they grow into their sense of purpose and meaning. It is full of the love of the staff who have served it, full of their hopes for this congregation, their hard work, and their acts of dedication. It is full of the love of the choir, the love made so clear in the voices lifted here on Sunday mornings. This is the home that love made. It is full of our love, the love of this community, despite our differences and our disagreements, the love that holds us together as a people. This is the home that love made. Can you feel it? May the love be with us always. And let us light our chalice. Judy's going to light it, and I hope that you will say the words with each other and with me. We kindle this chalice flame to remind ourselves of the light of truth, the warmth of community, and the fire of commitment.
Me in body or spirit, as we sing together hymn number 134, 134, Our World is One World. So much. Please be seated.
Welcome. to the February 12th, 2023 Sunday service at the First Unitarian Universalist Society of Burlington, Vermont. We acknowledge that our meeting house and grounds near the edge of Lake Champlain, Be Twabach, or the waters in between, are located on the ancestral and unceded homelands of the Western Abnaki people, who continue to live with us here in community. We honor and respect the Abnaki as the traditional stewards of this land, and strive to respect and protect this land while continuing to honor the legacy of Vermont's indigenous people. I'm Judy Brooke, a member of the Worship Associates team. Joining me today are the Reverend Patricia Hart, Developmental Senior Minister, Margot Whitcomb, Faith Development Assistant, our own UU choir, old and new friends, a meeting house full of them, including those of you joining us live streaming from home, even as far away as Alaska. It's so good to be together. If you are new to the UU and are feeling brave, would you be willing to raise your hand so we can extend to you a special welcome? There. Welcome. We'd like to get to know you better. So please fill out the card in the pew rack and place it in the collection basket or hand it to one of our welcome ambassadors. Today, someone will be in touch with you. Today's welcome ambassadors are Susan Warner Mills and Marilyn Brill. Susan and Marilyn, would you please stand up and just give a wave? There they are. We also have a welcome table at our coffee hour behind these, no, downstairs in the community room after today's service. Come, let us meet you there. And now, let's take a minute to greet one another in this time of COVID that might be by a wave or a heart tap. We are a liberal religious community, guided by eight principles and a living tradition which draws from the wisdom of the world's religions, which inspire us in our ethical and moral life. We're an active congregation. After this service, there is the before-mentioned in-person coffee hour downstairs, a second Sunday circle meeting in the parlors to discuss parts of today's service, a youth group meeting on Tuesday, and a love and justice vigil on Wednesday. So check out the latest newsletter on our newsletter or website, uusociety.org, to find out more of which you become active. Special thanks to all who made this service possible. James Stewart, Director of Music, Sam Weitzel, Pianist, the choir, Margot Whitcomb, as I mentioned, the tech team up in the balcony. Facilities manager David McFeeters. No matter who you are, where you come from, what you believe, you're welcome here. Come, let us worship together.
We're about to have some fun. What would you do if I sang out to you? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing, we'll sing you a song. And we'll try not to sing out of key.
Everybody, I'm Margot Whitcomb. I'm the Faith Development Assistant with Erica Reef, who finally had a day off. As some of you may know, my other life is in the theater, and as we say in that business, that is a hard act to follow. Okay, I have a short reflection for us this morning. So first, I do want to ask all the children from way little on up to, I see we have some eighth graders and high schoolers here, and you're more than welcome. Adults are welcome as well. But I'm going to have you this time join Penny. Penny, can you wave to everybody? This is Penny up at by the central doors. If all the children could go meet Penny that way, she's going to give you a prize and give you some instructions before you come down this way. Sorry I don't have enough prizes for everyone this morning. So meanwhile, I want to engage you adults in a short greeting. I know you've greeted everyone, but now we're going to actually, because I didn't bring a prize, you're going to get a prize from somebody else in a little gift-giving greeting in the spirit of our beloved community that we are celebrating today. So I will give you some instructions and a little demonstration here, and then give you a go. And you'll be able to do this sitting or standing as you please, or as you are able. Though if you stand, it is a little easier to express your full enthusiasm. And you can't get this wrong either. So just remember, this is play. It's always so hard to get adults to sort of go back. You know, when I teach improv or anything like that, kids always say, like, you know how they say, pick me, and they all raise their hands. And then when you do it with adults, they say, don't pick me. No one raises their hands. So this is your chance to play and use your imagination. So you identify someone close to you to meet and greet, and it can be the person you just spoke to, because now you're going to give them a gift, or someone else. You'll say hello and your name, and then they'll say theirs. And whoever the first person is who spoke will give an imaginary gift to the other person, establishing it with their hands and saying, "This is for you." And you will use your biggest imagination, though it might be a very tiny or very large box or container. The person receiving the gift opens the box, this is the important part, and says thank you for, and you fill in the blank. So the receiver gets to declare and name the gift. So this is your opportunity to get anything you've ever wanted. And that person says, "This is for you," and gives you the gift. And that person then returns and says, "This is back for you," and gives you a gift. Let your imagination and enthusiasm run wild. And now James has generously agreed to play this game with me. He's gonna come on up here, and we'll both sort of share this mic and try to be loud enough. And I would say, "Hi, I'm Margo."
"Hi, I'm James."
"Oh, James, I have this gift for you."
"Oh my goodness, it's so beautifully wrapped. I'm gonna set it, there's something alive in here." "It's a puppy!" All right, so I have something for you.
Oh.
It's a little small.
Oh, a 12-carat diamond?
Well, I saw you had your eye on it.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
That's it. So it's really easy. And the children, if you're ready, you can do it too to one another. So now it's your turn. Don't think about it too much. Stand up as you are able. Pick somebody to talk to. We'll do it on go. Make lots of noise. 1, 2, 3, go! You won the prize. So now if the children can come on down. Thank you. Penny, can I have you bring the children on down? So clearly, I think the next thing on the agenda should be for me to teach a theater games workshop for the adults here at the Society, because you were great players. Was that fun? Okay, good. So here's one more thing you have to do. I'm going to tell a story. It's actually a rhyme. I love rhymes. You all can come all the way down here to hear the story. And you have a part. We're going to do a responsive reading. So your line is, we are all connected. Very simple. It's said 6 times in this poem. And I hope you will say it robustly. That's practice, okay? 1, 2, 3. We are all connected. Oh, little more gusto, okay? 1, 2, 3. We are all connected. Yes! Okay, good. All right, so here's the story. Hi, chill kids. Here's the story. It's actually a poem freely adapted from the book We Are All Connected, Taking Care of Each Other and the Earth, written by Gabby Garcia, illustrated by Natalia Jimenez Osorio. We all live on one blue dot spinning in space. We are all part of one human race. We have hopes and dreams and love in our hearts. We are stronger together than we are apart.
We are all connected.
We must be kind. We must be fair. So why all the fuss to compete and compare when it feels so much better to connect and to share? We can share when we're sad or down in the dumps. We can share our joys, give high fives or fist bumps. When we're all seen and heard, trust blooms and grows. Kindness ripples and flows. Let's speak up for others, include and embrace. We all make mistakes, as I just did. We can give each other grace. We have more in common than we may believe. We can celebrate differences, lend a hand, learn from each other, take a stand.
We are all connected.
Let's raise our voices. We can work together to make brave choices. Protect the water, care for the land, respect all being. The earth is grand. Nature gives her bounty. She is gentle yet mighty. Stand in awe of her force. Preserve her beauty. Let's look under rocks and explore vast skies. Honor the mountains and chase butterflies.
We are all
connected. Let's seek peace. Let's go hunting for rainbows. Plant more trees. Let's grow a garden and be friends with the bees. Our earth is our home and needs our care. We all play a part. We breathe the same air. We belong to the earth. It is not ours. We are all made of stars. So the children can follow Penny as they process their stars and show them to the congregation. We are all made of stars. And finally, as Judy Brook pointed out to me when I shared this reading, it was actually Carl Sagan, who many of us from my generation will remember as a famous astronomer, who said, "We are the stuff that stars are made of." In non-scientific terms, he meant that all living and non-living things on this planet are made from this planet. It's minerals, molecules, and atoms. That is our community, what we share. So now, anyone who would care to join us for the classes, along with our teachers and all of the children and our stars, we'll head down to class. Have a wonderful service. Thank you.
Let us take this opportunity to deepen into a time of meditation. Let's take a deep breath together, breathing in the breath of life, breathing out the breath of peace, and come into a place of sacred listening. Deep sorrow for the people of Turkey and Syria, suffering devastating losses in the earthquake that hit on Monday, and for the rescuers facing daunting odds and hardships and trauma. Concern for the citizens of Ukraine living at war, facing a cold winter and the invader, Russia. Condolences for Ginger and Chris Williamson and their family following the sudden death of Chris's brother, Mark, who died last week when he had a heart attack while skiing. Joy that the Edmond Shelter community opened this week, so we have many new neighbors, some of whom came to breakfast this morning, along with people from the Philippines. Joy for paper white narcissus, small flowers filling the house with sweet perfume. And joy for light-filled longer days. As we enter a brief period of silence, let us hold that which has been spoken and that which remains unspoken tenderly in our hearts. And when the music begins, you are invited to come forward and place a small stone from the basket onto the table, signifying your joy or sorrow, along with others' joys and sorrows. Now, let us share the silence.
Thank you.
In this community, may the joys and the sorrows of each of us be held, become the joys and sorrows of us all. We take up an offering every week in the midst of our worship together to remember that it's us. It is us. It is us, including those who are at a distance, who make this congregation possible with our presence, our energy, and our financial support as well. The offering this month is shared, as it always is, this month with the King Street Center, which is a community nonprofit in Burlington that provides children and family core life-building skills that they need for a healthy and productive future. Your gifts today, any day this month, will help the King Street Center serve more than 100 children and teens every day. You're welcome to give online, of course, or by mail if you're a person that still remembers to fill out how to, I don't even know how to write checks anymore, but I'm sure I could figure it out, and they still work. Or if you are moved to and would like to bring something up to put it in the basket, you're welcome to do that as well. Your gifts always make all the difference. Would you speak together the words of our offering dedication? With gratitude, we dedicate these gifts in the service of our mission to inspire spiritual growth, care for each other and our community, seek truth, and act for justice.
Thank you.
So what's money got to do with it? Judy, Brooke, and I were talking about money and church and memories this week, and she and I both remember, though we grew up in different religious traditions, she and I both remember having a box of envelopes. Anybody else remember this? Ooh, lots of people. And so the idea was you got a box of envelopes, and the box had your name on it. I don't think the envelopes did, but they were numbered, as I recall. My siblings have very imprecise memories of this, which doesn't, I don't know what to make of that, but I remember it, and I remember that I think it was a nickel that I, from my allowance, which I think was 25 cents. It's a good thing the children are downstairs, they'd be terribly shocked at that. Putting a nickel into the envelope and bringing it with me to church so that I could put it in the basket. And the idea was of the numbering was that there was an envelope for every week, and the goal, of course, was to have a perfect record. So if you did miss a Sunday, you could bring two, I think. I remember that. When I think back to that, I freely admit to you that I did not understand why this mattered. I didn't understand why it mattered to my parents, but I knew it did. I did get that church was about being good, and somehow the way that was demonstrated was by showing up. By showing up, by being dressed up and showing up to church. It mattered that we were there, my family, on Sundays. And even though I didn't find it a terribly comfortable place, and I thought the service often went on longer than it really needed to, it nevertheless was a place that I kind of knew on some level that I belonged. This was my place. And I also kind of understood that failing to show up would have been somehow a sign of selfishness, at least, but actually probably, and because I was a Catholic, of my sin. Not showing up was not a good thing. And all of this was both confusing to me and upsetting as a child, and thus my strategy was to do what was expected of me and not to talk about it. In my family, good Irish Catholic family, we did not talk about religion. Ever. We didn't talk about being good. We didn't talk about sin. It was like there, but we didn't talk about it. And money was somehow included in that list of things that we didn't talk about. The strategy worked well enough until I became a teenager, and by that time I was quite experienced in not bringing up difficult topics around my parents, and that was when I stopped going to church entirely. And we never talked about that either. 16 years later, after I left religion for good, a surprising thing happened. I was in my early 30s. I was married. I had a husband and three small boys, and we moved to Maine, and we started attending the First Universalist Church of Yarmouth. Many of you have heard me talk about that church and how formative it was for me. I signed the membership book pretty quickly. I'm not quite sure I understood what I was doing. I think I remember saying that to the minister the day I signed the membership book. I said, I'm really glad to be here, and I'm glad to sign the book, and I have to say it makes me a little nervous because I think this religion is going to expect something of me. I didn't understand what it was at the time. And I was quite determined at that point to limit my involvement to the choir and nothing else. That first year that my husband and the children and I were there, when pledge season came along, we figured that we were just too new to worry about any of it, and we put some money in the offering plate when it went by most weeks, so maybe that was good enough. But the next year, canvas dinner. The word canvas confused me too, but I did get that it was about money and making pledges. And canvas dinner in that church in those days was a rollicking event. I mean, you wanted to be there. It was a fancy potluck affair with tablecloths and candles and entertainment. The minister was really funny in that church. There was a lot of laughter on canvas dinner night, and there was a pledge card right there next to the desserts on the table. So I took it home. My husband and I thought about what we could put down as our financial commitment for the coming year, and I'm pretty sure that the number that we chose was $400 for the year. It doesn't sound like all that much now, though I did look it up. Thank you, Google. $400 in 1987 is worth more than $1,000 in 2022. It made me nervous to do this. I wasn't making any money at that point. I didn't have a job outside the home. I was lucky enough to be a full-time parent. Didn't feel like luck every day, but it was luck. My husband had a job, a pretty good job, and so with his paycheck, we could buy groceries, we could take the kids out for supper occasionally, we could pay the mortgage on our drafty 1850s house, and perhaps even more astounding, we could pay the oil bill. One more monthly check, I knew how to write them then, seemed manageable. I did not understand the finances of my church at that point. I did not try. But pledging to give a certain amount of money seemed to matter a lot to these people that I had joined and was coming to care about. So that was a good enough reason. We made that pledge. I think we paid it all. And that was the beginning of pledging for me. And it hasn't stopped. Except for a few years when I was going to seminary and getting divorced, I have pledged every year, some years to more than one congregation since I keep moving around. I'm not sure that I could convince you or even myself that giving all those dollars to Unitarian Universalist congregations was the smartest financial decision that Peter and I could have made. What I know is that it has been somehow an essential part of my coming to know who I am in the world, who my people are, where I belong, what we together strive to be and do, how we choose to show up in the world, not just inside our sanctuaries, how we commit to being citizens and neighbors with those who seem like-minded and those who are almost certainly not. Being a Unitarian Universalist means being part of a covenanted community in which people make promises to one another and to something larger than us, which we may or may not have words for. Promises about how we will be and toward what end. Promises that include sharing with one another and the larger community as of our gifts and our treasure as we can. I started learning all that way back in 1987, almost a decade before I went to seminary, actually, and I'm still learning, which is why I decided to talk to you about it today. Actually, I don't want to talk about it. It is not easy to talk about money and why it matters. All that not talking I learned as a kid, it stuck. I checked with my siblings yesterday. It is a wonderful and quite miraculous thing that my siblings and I, almost all of us, almost every Saturday, this is all because of the pandemic, now have a Zoom call. And so I told them a week ago Saturday, I said, okay, when we talk next week, I'm going to ask you a question, which is, what did you learn from our family of origin about money? And then I had to go. My sister actually put her hand up immediately. She said, me, I want to talk about that. So we did talk about it yesterday on the phone, on Zoom. And they got the same message, that not talking about money is better than talking about it. My sister Judy, the one who had her hand up, actually said that the first thing that she remembers about money and about talking about money in our family was our mother saying to her some question she had asked, "It is none of your business." So we learned how to do that not talking thing. And money, frankly, seems especially ill-suited to a faith community. This is meant to be a safe, beautiful, comforting, inspiring sanctuary. Money sets people's teeth on edge. It brings up feelings like embarrassment, annoyance, agitation, anger, grief, and shame. We heard a good bit about this a couple of weeks ago at a wonderful listening circle that our treasurer, Zoe Hart, organized with some help from others. The listening circle after the service was called Our Money, Our Values. Did I get that right? And there were about 24 people there, both in person and on Zoom, and we were all invited to offer our perspectives on the question of whether stewardship, pledge season, was inconsistent with the goal of being radically welcoming, especially for those whose personal situations are such that making a financial commitment of a specific amount is unrealistic, if not impossible. That's true. And it turns out that it's not just people with limited money who feel uncomfortable. It's just about everybody. If I don't feel bad about how much I'm pledging, I might well be worried that others who are in the room and listening are finding talking about it excruciating. Money is almost certainly the most loaded topic in Unitarian Universalism. And that's because, in case you haven't figured this out, that's because we don't do guilt. I have heard colleagues and longtime Unitarian Universalists say that if we could just bring guilt back for a month and the year, we might be able to, but it's not going to happen. About a decade ago, actually a little longer than that, an advisory council at the UUA said, you know what, this is such a problem, talking about money, and money is a problem. We need something like OWL, but for money. OWL is Our Whole Lives, the amazing sexuality curriculum that our congregation and many, many others offer. So we need OWL for money. And that was kind of a joke for a while, and then some people decided to do it. The class exists. It's called The Wisdom Path. You can find it on UUA.org. Anyone can. It's 12 sessions designed to have the participants build awareness of our own stories about money, explore how money connects people and divides people, how it's central to classism and economic injustice, as well as all kinds of stuff in congregational life. And the goal, of course, of the Wisdom Path is to align the faith and the values and the sense of calling with how we feel and act about money. It's a great curriculum. I was lucky enough to be one of the readers as the curriculum was being developed. And I asked the remarkable woman who actually was the final editor on this, I said, what are you going to do about facilitators for this class? And she said, oh, well, ministers will probably facilitate this class. I said, that strikes me as a terrible idea. Because ministers are often not, frankly, very aligned with their goals and their attitudes and their ability to talk about money. The Wisdom Path is still a good curriculum. It's not used very often. It's just too much for people. I'll just give you a tiny little taste. This is part of a reading from the first session of the Wisdom Path, and it's a quote from a book called The Soul of Money, Transforming Your Relationship with Money and Life by Lynn Twist, who wrote, "In our private lives, we all, at one time or another, have demeaned and devalued ourselves, taken advantage of people, or engaged in other actions we're not proud of in order to get or keep money or the power we believe it can buy." She doesn't stop there. "We've silenced ourselves." Oh, wait, not talking. "We've silenced ourselves to avoid conflicts or uncomfortable interactions over money. Money is sometimes used as an instrument of control or punishment, emotional escape or manipulation, or as a replacement for love." Good grief. If money is that powerful and that bad, then maybe we should just avoid talking or thinking about it. There are two big problems with that strategy, neither of which has to do with the society's need to keep the lights on. How many of you have heard that expression here or anywhere else? You know, we need to keep the lights on. I have never liked that image, since lights, you know, are cool, but they're not the most important thing that we have to worry about, especially here where the solar panels in the parking lot produce enough electricity to keep the lights and the computers and the security cameras and everything else running for this entire building. Did you know that? It's amazing. It has nothing to do with pledging, except, of course, that our pledges make it possible to hire and fairly compensate staff who work with members to come up with cool ideas like that. Okay, two problems. First problem, with not talking. As Unitarian Universalists, we commit to making important decisions about our important, beloved congregations together. We have a covenant that says that. Our fifth principle, the use of the democratic process that we affirm and promote in our congregations. Members, here's how things work. Members and staff come up with ideas for programs, new ones, changing the ones we exist. We have members who call, who hire a minister, figure out that we're paying them what they're worth. People volunteer to help with everything in this congregation: membership, faith development, Sunday morning breakfast, so many others. And to pay for all of that, the staff drafts a budget, the board reviews it, but then the people, the members, vote whether or not to pass that budget or occasional allocations from the meeting house fund. Money is a part of everything. So we can't possibly make such democratic decisions without talking about money, figuring out our priorities, arguing about doing the right thing, not just the way things have always been done. Here's the second problem. Thinking and talking about money, I would argue, is essential for this congregation to be able to live out its mission. Remember the mission statement? We exist to inspire spiritual growth, you can say it with me, care for each other and our community, seek truth, and act for justice. Well, you can't do any of those things well alone. You might be able to seek truth by yourself and manage to avoid all consideration of the role that money might play, the negative power of money and the positive transformative power too. But none of us, I think, is likely to do a very good job if we can't work on understanding and finding truth together, and if we aren't figuring out what to do next together with each other, which I think is the biggest part of inspiring spiritual growth. Taking on hard questions together and supporting each other as we do, caring for one another too. Without this congregation, which exists in part through financial contributions of its people, living that mission, well, it just wouldn't happen. We wouldn't have each other. Not like this. So I'm glad that Peter and I have pledged financial support to all those congregations over the years. I have no way of knowing, none of us does, the extent to which of the impact that those faith communities have made and are making in real people's lives. But I'm grateful, deeply grateful, that I've played some part in making those churches, fellowships, or congregations, or societies real and alive in the world through my work and with my money. It doesn't matter whether we give a little or a lot. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if there's a year that you can't give anything at all. It doesn't matter whether you join five committees or none. You're still a part of this place. These are your people. Some of them remote too. The community that you claim and that claims you. This is a place where we all belong. Which brings us back to love. Money can be destructive, yes, indeed. It is also one of the ways in which we give of what we have, what we are, in service of what we love. What better way is there to spend money than to care for, I don't know, our children, our grandchildren, mine, yours, the neighbors, to care for our parents, our siblings, our elders, and our friends. Everyone in your life who has taught you what really matters. Call one of those people to mind. Everybody who has taught you what really matters, taught you what you are and can be in the world. The strangers, we need to help them. I don't know about you, but when I see a GoFundMe account for something that makes a difference, I do give money, and I do it because I want to, because it makes me remember who I am in the world. If I can do something, I'm going to try to do it. That's partially what Unitarian Universalism has taught me. This month in the PATH, the Soul Matters material, which most of you got or you can find on the website, there's a little piece from a Canadian poet named Shane Coisen. I highly recommend their work to you. This is just a little quote that stuck with me. Know that love is a vulnerability, but not a weakness. Love is the volunteer in you that raises its hand and steps forward without needing to be rewarded. Love is a currency that functions in reverse because the only way to be wealthy with it is to give more of it away. This is the home that love made. So much love through the decades and so much love from you now, your love to give away, whether you've been here for decades or just arrived today. This is the home that love has made, that your love is making now. Can you feel it? Let's sing one more time.
I'd like to invite you to join me in body or spirit as we stand and sing together hymn number 299, Make Channels for the Streams of Love.
say the chalice words with me? We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and share with the world until we are together again. Our benediction is from the Reverend John C. Morgan. In the end, it won't matter how much we have, but how generously we have given. It won't matter how much we know, but rather how well we live. And it won't matter how much we believe, but how deeply we love. So may it be. Go in peace.